I came a couple of weeks ago to do Belfast, which was great. I'd not done anything there. And then I had to go up to Cambridge to give a talk, and then I went to Romania, to Bucharest, which was fantastic. It's an opening world there. And I'm so enchanted, actually. I had 4 days, and my wife and I hired a car and just drove up into Transylvania. So beautiful, so beautiful. Then back to Paris last weekend to do a signing, and then this week we spent in Dusseldorf, and now here. So it's good to be back. Old territory. People are fascinated by Fringe still. Absolutely. And Fringe has had a rebirth, a complete rebirth of late because of the Netflix. Whereas it was a moderately successful show, you know, it ran 5 seasons, with a really fine fan base, it's now out of control because of this, the new releases on Netflix. I mean, seriously, out of control. 10 times popular, more popular than it ever was. So that's the main one. Also, Walter Bishop was such an interesting character, I think. Denethor comes into it a bit, I must admit. To start with, Walter Bishop was a character that you, if you had a dream of a perfect character to play as a character actor, you'd say, give me Walter Bishop. And I was very, very fortunate that the writers also went with me and I went with them. So that when they realised that I was basically up for anything, they kept giving me anything, and then I would invent something else. And so it went. I finished up playing about 14 versions of him eventually. It was a total joy. But the main thing that worked, apart from the very interesting science, which we always tried to keep within the realms, the possibilities of theoretical physics, believe it or not. That was my request to the writers. Please at least make it feasible that we can go there. So if they came up with an experiment that was just rubbish, I'd say, please don't make me do that, because the fans will know and I know, and it's not so good. And they did. They were fantastic. A couple of the first season were a bit dodgy. But it was mainly the relationships. The relationship between Walter and his son, between Anatole's character, Jessica Nicole. I mean, it's just this incredible bond that was built up over time. And that, I know from talking to people, is what they found enchanting. And it was fascinating. For the first time, people would come up, this is the only show that we could ever watch as a family. I thought, gee, that's a lovely thing to say about a show, isn't it? And so the fan group was all ages, both genders, right across the board. And families would watch together. I think it's a pretty fantastic thing in this day and age. I'm not a scientist, but I have a deep and abiding passion for it, and particularly theoretical side, you know, the future. I'm spellbound by the possibilities that are being revealed all the time. And I don't have to be a scientist. I mean, there's some fantastic literature around, which is quite dense, but you don't have to understand pure maths to do it. And so that's probably my main reading, I suspect. Fascinating stuff. What I have over the character was interpretation. With television, you don't change dialogue. And I wouldn't. Simple reason is, by the time we get it, it's gone through so many channels and so many filters that if I wanted to change something, then it would have to go back through those cycles again. So it'd have to go all the way back. And so I never did that. But they allowed me to interpret and to improvise a lot within the context. So that was a dream. Going to work was a dream for me. And it was always fun, you know, such crazy things. Just the way to deliver a line sometimes would be just such fun. And I'd be thinking, how on earth do I deliver that? And I'd be sitting, and suddenly it would come to me in a taxi or something. I'd like, that's it. It was bizarre, out of left field, but it was the right one. I had to go with it. It was one of those quirks that became very much a Walterism. And it's consistent with the obsessiveness, you know. And he's a fairly addictive personality as well, so that was consistent. And there were other quirks as well, the fact that he could never get Astrid's name right until the finale, you know, and that was such a beautiful thing to play over 5 years, trying to think of new names for it. She would all have scratching her head, saying, she'd say, why don't you call me that? So it went on until the final, I think it was the final episode where I said, Astrid, that's a beautiful name, and she cried. Such a sweetheart. I know that JJ, at the time that he he was putting this together. And when he met with Alex Gertzman and Roberto Orci, they said, we want to write an important show about a father-son because it hadn't been done. And so they built this thing in. Working with Joshua and I really clicked at all levels. And in fact, I think of him as a son, really. And we just played. We always had the best relationship going. And we could play the tensions and all the tensions and all the joys very easily for us. Anna was such a hard woman in the beginning, so locked in. I don't know if you remember the early seasons of it. She was really liberated when we went to the alternate universe. And everyone realised what a superb actress she is. And they're going, oh, my God, she's not this stitched-up person in grey. She's this fabulous, sexy lady. And she enjoyed that very much. And then the relationship between... I mean, I'm also extremely fond of Anna and a fellow Australian. And so that was pretty easy to play, to be honest. But none of these things happened overnight. There were slow builds and ups and downs. And we even did some shows where, beginning of season four perhaps, where Joshua wasn't in the timeline. So I had to play Walter without a Joshua. And that was very tricky because there was nothing redeeming. I sort of made him this obsessive compulsive character who was rescued because of his scientific knowledge, but nothing else. And he was still quite ill and distracted. I'm glad that finished. That was really hard to do. So when Josh finally came back, yay! It's like sliding doors, isn't it? You know, what happens in our life to take us in one direction or another. It was the same man with all of the same characteristics, the same level of intelligence, the same looks, but one went a certain path and finished up because of his work being put into a mental asylum and basically reduced to shambles. And the other one was put in a position of authority and therefore went on to become a state leader. Both the same men. And my favourite scene, my favourite scene, you may recall, it was when the two of them finally got down to sit and have a talk to each other. And I'd always wanted that to happen. Then they shot this beautiful scene of just the two of us sitting in a corridor talking to each other intimately about something. Oh, such a joy to do. So, I think the most radical thing we did was the alternate universe, which, as you probably know, is incredibly feasible. And so it wasn't too much of a stretch in theory. And it's funny, I had a friend who is a scientist, when I was at university, and I shared a flat with him, and he's crazy. He's truly crazy. And I based Walter Bishop largely on him, to be honest with you. But we would sit down sometimes at nights and we would work then on the laws of probabilities that there must be, simply by the laws of probabilities, for example, an exact duplicate of what we are here. There must be in an eternal. And so that's, these sorts of thoughts have been with me for a very long time. And that my friend is still a crazy scientist and still fighting the establishment every chance he gets. What happens with the show is that they really need to reboot each year. And I think all television series do that, unless it's just a straight procedural, like Special Victims Unit or something. Then that is a straight procedural, which very successfully goes. But with these types of shows, they really need to reboot, find another way. And that's what they had to do on, four occasions after the opening. So you don't really know. They also listened quite closely now to what the fans say. What works for the fans. And there were ideas, for anyone observing, that came in and just disappeared. Like, where did that go? It just disappeared because it wasn't holding, wasn't progressing us. The glorious thing about Fringe was we were given a fifth season, limited fifth season, and Fox said it was to finish a story. And, the choice then was what was projected into the future, and we tried to tie up a lot of loose ends in that 13-episode arc. That was very... You know how there's the reputation of people closing shows in the middle of it, and I was really thrilled that they did that. Whether it was satisfactory to the fans, I don't know, but at least we finalised a lot of those story arcs that went through. Oh, look, there's a lot of people would love to see Fringe again. Mm. Seriously, I don't know where the reboot would be. I know that it would, to me, it would be essential to have at least four of the central characters back. That being Joshua's character, Anna's character, Jessica's character, and my character. And then, you know, there's some wonderful characters as well, like Blair Browns and Lance Reddick. So I don't know. I don't know what they'd do. I'd be the first to sign on. Seriously. I mean, it all depends on availability. I mean, I know Josh is doing another show at present. I'm going back to do another show. Anna's doing a film at present. So it's kind of not always as easy as it sounds, unless you're all unemployed actors, which could happen easily. We just got lucky.
How did you feel about particularly that final episode? How did that sit with you?
Well, it almost had to be that. It almost had to be that. We couldn't diminish Walter. We didn't know what to do with him. So what we did was projected him into a world where he would be comfortable. And that made sense of the whole observer track through the thing as well, played by the brilliant Michael Cerveris. He's another one I would definitely want back in. Whether we'll get him or not, he's just been nominated for another Tony Award on Broadway, so we may not get him. He's the nicest man and he's brilliant. And the father-son going back to their child, which had been raised. You can't leave... I don't think you can leave things like that open-ended. I think you need to go back and sort them out. And we lost a few people on the way. We killed off a Blair. And the Horsemen of War was a surprise to me, to be honest with you. When Alex Kurtzman rang me about that role, he painted this wonderful picture of this duplicitous fellow who just appears to be a nice old guy, but he has this incredible subtext running through it. And I loved that season one. It was so gorgeous because all the way through, I was planting little clues, but no one knew. And even the other actors forgot what was going on. And I remember Tom Meissen saying to me at the end, he said, oh God, I forgot you were going to do that, because he was this nice old fellow that was helping him out. It was a gorgeous play. The first season was a gorgeous play. Second season lost its way a bit. Third season is about to be... there's a reboot happened. I don't know what it is because I'm not involved. I'm out of the show now. But I suspect it's very good. But it will focus on the two leads. And I'm gone. Catcher's gone. Orlando... anyway, three or four of us are gone. History. And so they'll go back to what they believe is the core of it, which is the relationship between Nicole and Tom. That's what they believe. The wonderful girl called Lindy Greenwood, I think, is going to stay there as well. She's a fantastic girl, a wonderful actor too. The rest of us are history. Alex spoke to me earlier and said, look, if he can work it, would I come back as a guest? And I said, yes, in theory, but I don't think I'll be able to because I'm actually going back to work for another network. So it's not going to be that easy, not this year anyway.
Peter Jackson, yep. J.J. Abrams, can you talk a little bit, I guess, particularly about both of them and what distinguishes them in your mind as directors?
There's a similarity. There's a similarity between the two of them. I just want to make mention, by the way, that we've just lost Andrew Lesney, who's the DOP on All the Rings. Just the nicest man, and a genius. And what we see out there on those screens is his creation. And I'm hurt by that because he was 58. Anyway, both of them are incredibly enthusiastic, almost childlike in their enthusiasm. These men, obviously, they're brilliant. And they have the ability to inspire other people. Jackson, I noticed, when he did Rings, I couldn't believe going to New Zealand and seeing that everyone there was working at their optimum and that the bar was up here and everyone went for it. I mean, everyone. Nobody, there was no negativity at all on that set and everyone was just going for the best they'd ever done. And that showed in the movies. I mean, actors, costume, everything was that. And then JJ just has this extraordinary, again, it appears almost childlike, but believe me, it's not. This imagination that flies so fast. To talk to JJ, you have to really be on your toes because he's very sharp and very enthusiastic. He talks very fast and you go, whoa, slow down, slow down. But I like both of the men very much indeed. Yeah, probably the role. It's nothing to do with film and television. Mm. I probably will do King Lear one day, because from the time that a young actor goes in, he says, "One day I'll be good enough if I'm not too old." And that's the problem. It's really demanding. You've got to be old, really old, to do it. But I think that's on the card.
Prosthetics now.
Yeah. No, it's not the same.
As
the, well, Hamlet is for the younger men, and then you've got Juliet, who's amazing role for a 15-year-old. You know, yeah. These are very tough things to do. Anyway, that's not what we're here to talk about, but that's probably what I would do. Oh, it even makes me shiver to think of it, because it's so hard. I went back and read it again a couple of years ago, and I said, why do you let this go, John? It's so hard. But having just gone back to stage and done a couple of things, I'll go it.
When JJ was announced that he was going to be taking over the Star Wars universe, your name was first in a lot of people's suggestions as someone who was going to potentially feature in that. Was that just fan speculation, or was there ever any discussion about that? Is that something you'd even be interested in if it ever came up?
Yeah, I'd be interested for sure. I mean, as a franchise, that's maybe the greatest franchise.
And if you were, what would you choose to be? What would you like to be in the Star Wars mythos?
I don't know. I mean, if the rumours, I think Harrison Ford played the role I would play, and that's pretty good casting, frankly. So I have no hard feelings about that. It would be something of this stature, I think. I usually play characters of fair stature because of my size and my voice, so don't mind playing baddies.